everyone. Welcome to another night of Children's Church Conference we have for going on for 2020. We appreciate everything that you guys have done. We're hoping we'll be able to bring this to your guys' living rooms, houses, wherever you're at, children's churches, so we can bring something to you guys and minister to you, because it is a privilege, and we just want you guys to be able to bury something in your hearts for the rest of the year, and hopefully we guys can see you guys next year. First song we're going to be doing, it's a cappella, so you guys are going to have to help us out. We have no music. First song is going to be Devil Sitting on a Railroad Track. We want to get some of those wiggles out, but we also want to get the devil out of here too, okay?
That's right.
You guys ready? Awesome. So everyone first, go ahead and stand up. Everyone standing up? Great. Okay, so super simple. All you have to do is repeat after me. So first line is, Devil sitting on a railroad track.
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 You guys got the idea? Okay, yeah. Ready? And devil sitting on a railroad track.
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 All right, now I need everyone's best train noises, okay? Chugga 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 together. Chugga 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 chugga. Make a fart noise. No more devil.
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 Diablo no más.
Diablo no más.
All right. Now we got all the wiggles out and the devils out. We're going to go ahead and start with the next song. It's a little slower. We're going to invite the presence of God into this place, and we can be able to use that presence to be able to minister to you. So this is one of my favorite songs ever. It's called Praise Adonai. Hopefully you guys know the words. If not, just quiet your hearts and pray to God, because we all know we're going through a lot right now. We want to do everything we can to support each other, okay? So all together now.
Who is like him, lion and the lamb, seated on the throne? Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints, sing praise. Who is like him, the lion and the lamb, seated on the throne? Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Come praise him, praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints, sing praise.
All right, we just want to go ahead and slow it down. Lord, we thank you for this time and this opportunity to be able to minister to your children, God. We just ask that you give us strength and peace of mind while we go through such tough times. You'll be able to overshadow us and heal us and all those that are going through turmoil, God, that you'd be able to just lift their spirits. Now, everyone, we know everyone's going through a lot right now. We're doing what we can to stay together as a church and be able to just kind of bring everyone together. And I know you might have some prayers and some needs that we want to talk about, maybe going back to school, or, you know, families, you know, jobs, finances, anything like that. That could be something you're thinking about. We want to bring that up in prayer tonight, okay? So everyone just go ahead and bow your heads, close your eyes. I'm just going to open this up in prayer while we start this service, okay? Jesus, we thank you for this day and this opportunity to be able to minister to your children, God. We just ask that you would be able to bring us, God, clarity and revelation that we can be able to give to the children, and they can hide your word in their hearts as they go out, Lord, back out into the world and be able to go to schools, work, internships, anything, God, that they'll be able to spread your good news. We thank you for everything that you've done for us and everything that you will do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi, boys and girls. Miss Kathy here, gonna talk to you about what we're gonna learn about today.
All right. Hey, boys and
helpers.
Girls. Hello, how you doing? My name's Bobby the Brick.
And I'm Ashley Quadratics.
We're gonna be your fitness instructors here today for Conference 2020. All
right. Wait, fitness. Well, we're not talking about fitness. We're talking about trusting God's plan.
Yeah. Working out makes me feel like a new man, of course.
No. Trusting God's plan.
Nice to meet you, Stan.
My name's not Stan. It's Miss Kathy. We're talking about trust God.
Oh, yeah. No more dad bods. That's what we're here to get rid of. Right?
No. Trust God.
All right.
Yeah,
lunges.
These are AirPods.
No. We need to trust.
Oh, yeah. You're going to combust if you don't drop those pizza crusts. Get those out of here. We're going
to
be healthy.
No, we need to trust.
Yeah, you must stay healthy.
Exactly.
This is not what we're talking about today.
Great workout, kids. Great job. We'll see y'all tomorrow, okay?
Wait, stop. The kids haven't even learned anything.
Hey, it's okay. Relax. Just trust God.
Yeah. He's got a plan. See you tomorrow.
Hi, kids. It's time for the memory verse. Now, I'm going to take it slow because it's a long one tonight, okay? So, Jeremiah 29:11. Okay, I can't hear you back there. Come on, say it a bit louder. Jeremiah 29:11. Good. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Good, that was really good. Now let's try this again. Okay. What's that? Do you hear? It's Logan. Everybody say hi, Logan.
Hi. I need a seat. I can't stand for this long.
Oh, no. Somebody get him a seat. Get him a seat.
Okay.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. So we're doing the memory verse, Logan. Are you here to help us?
The what?
The memory verse.
Okay.
Okay, are you ready?
For what?
The memory verse.
You already said that.
I know, but you didn't hear me.
Oh, okay.
Okay, ready? Okay, Jeremiah 29:11.
Jeremiah 47:11.
That's not quite right. Right, kids? He didn't do it right. Let's try one more time. Say it real loud so he can hear you, okay? Jeremiah 29:11.
Jeremiah 29:27.
Close. It's closer. You got the first one. Okay, one more time. Louder, kids. Come on. I want to hear you. Jeremiah 29:11.
Jeremiah 29:11.
Oh, good job, Logan. Good job. Okay, let's continue. For I know I have cans. You have cans? Where are the cans?
I don't know. I'm just repeating what you say.
Okay, no, that's not what we said. Say it louder, kids. For I know the plans. I have for you.
I have for you.
Declares the Lord.
Declares the morgue.
No, Logan. Declares the Lord.
Declares the Lord.
Good job. Plans to prosper you.
Plans to give you a grasshopper.
Grasshopper? Did you guys hear me say? No, we didn't say grasshopper, Logan. It says plans to prosper you.
Plans to prosper you.
And not to harm you.
And not to harm you.
Good job. Plans to give you hope.
Plans to give you soap.
Yeah, I think you do need some soap, though. Yeah. Okay, no, that's not what we said, though. Plans to give you hope.
Plans to give you hope.
And a future.
And a future.
Good job, Logan. Great. Now, let's see if we can do it all the way through. Okay, you're going to listen very good, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Jeremiah 29:11.
Jeremiah 29:11.
For I know the plans. I have for you. Declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you. And not to harm you. Plans to give you hope. And a future. Great job. Didn't Logan do a great job, kids? Good job, Logan. Great. That was terrific.
I need to go take my nap.
Okay, everybody say bye, Logan.
Bye.
Bye. Have a good nap. That's great. Okay, we're going to do this one more time, kids. Okay, ready? Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, plans to give you hope and a future. Great job, kids. You guys take care. Bye.
In the book of Jeremiah, God says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." That scripture applies to all of us. We all are in God's plan. He knows what He wants to use us for. He's given us each a gift, a special gift, so that we can fulfill His will on earth. And this was true of Gideon. You might recall, the angel appeared to Gideon. He called him. He told him he was a mighty man of valor. And of course, Gideon, he just kind of sloughed that off because he didn't feel like a mighty man of valor. Do you feel like a child of valor? Do you feel like a boy of valor or a girl of valor? Because you are. Because valor doesn't come from how strong we are. It doesn't come from how smart we are. It doesn't come from how well we can do things. Valor comes from giving our life to Jesus and allowing Him to use it. And that's what Gideon did. He tested God a few times, but then finally he said, "This must be the time. I'm going to have to go and I'm going to fight the battle." Now remember when he blew that horn in our last story, and people gathered from all around. 32,000 men came to fight against the Midianites. They camped all around the land. Gideon was amazed at how many of them had showed up, especially since he was the one that was going to be the general, and he still wasn't quite as confident in himself as he probably should have been. I guess he believed God, but then maybe not so much. You know that feeling. We've all been there. He thought, 32,000 men? I could probably fight Midian with that many men. I mean, that's a lot of people, 32,000 people. It thought, it's going to be enough. We'll be able to do that. And he walked proudly through the army, looking at all his men, making his own plans for how he was going to defeat Midian. Then the Lord spoke. This happens a lot to Gideon. He thinks he's got a plan. He thinks he knows what direction he's going. And God speaks to him and he says, "You have too many people." What? Too many people? 32,000? God, have you seen the armies out there? The camels cover an entire plateau. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of camels alone, and multiple times that of the men. They have soldiers, trained soldiers. I need all 32,000. God said, "No." Said Gideon, "If you fight this battle with 32,000 men and you win the battle, Everybody's going to say, oh, Gideon, he's a great general. They're going to say, oh, these men of Israel, they're such great soldiers. But I don't want them to say that. I want people to know that the God of Israel has delivered them from the Midianites. And so I want you to willow down the men. Remember when we found Gideon in the first place? He was separating the chaff from the wheat. The way you do that is you throw it up in the air into the wind, and the wheat, which is heavy, will drop right back down. But the chaff, which is light, it'll blow away in the wind. And God said, I want you to use the same thing with these men. He says, first, you ask if they're fearful, if they're afraid. And if anybody's afraid, they should leave. Well, Gideon had a brave army. He knew he had a brave army. He'd seen them out there practicing with their swords and shouting their battle cries. He knew that they were brave, but he said it anyway. Okay, anybody here who's afraid, you can leave. To his amazement, most of the men left. He didn't know what to think. He looked, he watched. He watched as men began to leave and wander off, and they picked up their swords and they picked up their sticks and their clubs and they began to wander, going back home. And he watched them. 22,000 left. Two-thirds of his army were gone. And Midian was looking bigger and bigger all the time. Gideon started to get afraid, but then he thought, well, you know, God is with us, and, you know, we still have some men left. We still have 10,000. 10,000 should be enough. We should be able to defeat Midian with 10,000. If I really strategize, if I really figure out the battle plan, if I put my men just in the right areas, then surely we'll be able to defeat Midian with these 10,000 men that are left behind. But then God spoke again. Gideon, he said, you still have too many men. Now what was he to think? You know, he wondered with 32,000, he wondered with 10,000, but now he says 10,000 is too many men. And God says, take your men down to the water and tell them to go ahead and drink. Tell them to drink as much water as they want. And watch them. And if the men get down like dogs and they lap up the water, watch that. And some of the men are going to kneel. And some of the men who kneel will be looking around and they'll be very cautious. Well, Gideon thought, surely God is going to let me keep the ones that are very cautious. But God said, no, we want the others. And there weren't very many. There were only 300 men left that God had chosen. 300. Out of 32,000, not many men left. And Gideon, he was starting to get a little bit depressed. But he followed God's will. He sent all the men home that weren't fit for battle in God's little test. And he went and he prayed, because now he only had 300 men left. He looked down over the Midianites. Like sand on the beach, so many of them. How was he ever going to defeat them? Now God knew that Gideon was doubtful. And so God said, Gideon, if you're scared, he knew he was scared. He says, if you're scared, I want you to take your friend, Purah. And I want you to go down to the camp of the Midianites, sneak in by night and listen to what they're saying. Well, Gideon thought this was better than fighting them in battle, and he knew they could sneak in, and so they did. And he was afraid. He was very afraid, but he took his friend with him, and they went down, and they got to the very outposts, and they began to listen to the guard. They looked around, and they saw thousands and thousands of camels and tens of thousands of men. But then, one of the guards came up to the other, and he said, "You know, I had a dream last night." Now, Gideon knows that sometimes God works in dreams, and so he listened carefully. And the soldier said, "I dreamed that we were standing guard, and a loaf of barley bread came tumbling down the hill, and it came in and it wiped out a tent. And just, you wouldn't have thought a little barley loaf like that would do that, but it wiped out this tent completely." And his friend said, "Oh no, that barley loaf is the sword of Gideon." Now, they'd heard about Gideon, but they only heard the good things. They only heard how powerful his army was. They only heard how strong he was. And now, when one of these men had the dream, Gideon was the loaf of barley bread, and his sword was mighty. And he realized these guards were afraid of him and his army. And when he heard that, and when he heard them say they thought that Gideon was going to wipe them out completely, he began to worship God. And as he began to praise God, his strength began to come back to him. His confidence returned to him. And Gideon knew that God had delivered the Midianites into his hand. And he was ready to go into battle the next day. And the next time we come together, we'll talk about that battle. It won't be the type of battle that you might have thought it would be. If Hollywood were to stage this battle, they wouldn't do it the way God did. But God doesn't do things the way Hollywood does. God does things the way God does. You know, God, just as he had a plan for Gideon, he has a plan for you, and it might not be what you think it is. He doesn't want you to fight a great battle. He doesn't want you to fight with swords or guns, not necessarily. But he plans to have you prosper. Remember the scripture? He wants to prosper your life and keep you safe and give you hope for the future. And tomorrow we'll conclude the story, and we'll see how God's plans differ from ours. But God comes out the winner.
Doing in my toy box. No. Oh, I like this. What about this, Wormy? I could be King Fufu the Mighty. And if my subjects get out of line, they could sniff my golden fish. No? All right, fine. Let me see if I can find something else. No, don't like that. No, too silly. Too stupid. Too dumb. No, don't like it. No. Ooh. No. Goodness, there's all kinds of stuff in here. No. Okay, ooh. What about this? I could be a ninja. I've always liked to be ninjas. They're really cool. Look, and I can throw fireballs. Here, Doki! That was pretty cool. Nah. Come to think of it, I don't think ninjas get paid. Oh, I don't know what I'm gonna do. appointment is due on Monday, and I don't know what I'm going to be when I grow up. This is really hard. Oh, there's no hope. I don't know.
Hello, Fufu. What are you doing?
Oh, hi, Mr. Brandon.
What's all this? What you up to?
My teacher gave me an assignment to do,
mm-hmm.
and she wants me to write a few sentences about what I want to be when I grow up.
Oh, I see. What did you choose?
Oh, I haven't chosen anything. I'm having a tough time. I wanted to be like a fireman.
Well, that's a good choice.
Yeah, like because they got the axes,
mm-hmm.
and they like rescue people, kind of like. Like a superhero.
Just like it, yeah.
Yeah, but I remember that I've got food.
Oh, I see.
And I could catch on fire. And I don't want to be a fireman anymore. I'm too scared. Then I thought maybe I could be a ninja.
Yeah, that sounds exciting.
Yeah, I know. Like throwing stars up people's noses and like Judy Chapman. I think that's really exciting.
Yeah, I'd say so. But what's wrong with being a ninja?
Well, I don't know if they even get paid. Do they get paid, Mr. Brandon?
I know. I don't know what they get paid in. I'm sure they get paid something.
Really?
I don't know.
Oh. Well, maybe I'll be a ninja. I don't know, Mr. Brandon. This is really hard. I know I'm going to fail this. There's just no hope.
Oh, Fufu, there's plenty of hope for you. You know, the Bible, it says in Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." So if Jesus is in your heart, then Jesus has a plan for you. You get to be part of his plan to preach the gospel. So no matter what you choose, whether it's a king or a ninja or a firefighter,
you
get to preach the gospel. So you may be the only ninja gherkin out there. Somebody's going to preach all those little ninjas, don't they?
That's right. I didn't think about that. I'm excited now. I think I will. I think I can do something that will help. And I do have Jesus in my heart. So there is hope for me.
There's tons of hope for you, Fufu.
Oh, I'm so excited. Thank you, Mr. Brandon.
You're welcome, Fufu.
I'm going to go and write my paper now.
Okay, that's good.
I gotta practice all my Hadouken.
Yeah, practice your fireballs.
Yeah.
Hadouken!
Yeah, that's my favorite part. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome, Fufu.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hadouken!
You gotta listen to what Jesus say, 'cause you ain't seen nothing till you're touched by his love, and then you're sure to be changing your ways. I met a youth pastor, so I'm wearing off the list on how to find all the love I missed. So he told me about Jesus, and he gave me a reason, and the Bible told me how to live like this. Hey there, Christian, if you're John born at school, do you act like the Savior was there? When you're out late at night, did you stand for the right, or did you act like you didn't care? When you got the chance at the high school dance, did you say what God wants you to say? 'Cause the Lord ain't fooling, and he knows what you're doing, and he told us to live it today, when he told us to
walk his way, 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 walk his way.
Giving all, being what God wants her to be. There was three young ladies standing at their locker, making fun of her constantly. But she gave God glory, and she told them the story, how to find all the love they'd missed. Then the girls found Jesus, and today they're believers, 'cause the Bible told her how to live like this. care. Do you love one another, all you sisters and brothers? Do you say what God wants you to say? Cause the Lord ain't fooling and he knows what you're doing, and he told us to live it today when he told us to.
Walk his way, talk his way, walk his way, talk his way, walk his way.
Come on, we gotta get ready for the outreach. Hurry up. What do you mean?
I mean, I just don't feel like working today.
Come on, we have a lot of stuff we still have to do. The outreach is in like 2 hours, and we have all this stuff we have to prepare.
I've been thinking.
That's a first.
That was rude.
I'm sorry. I'm just kidding.
Anyways, what I'm trying to say is that I've been thinking. And I was wondering, why are outreaches so important? Like, what's the big deal about them anyways?
You're joking, right? It's important because that's how we reach out to people in our city and tell them about Jesus. I mean, it is our mission to go into all the world and preach the gospel.
I mean, I understand that. But why do we have to do it so often? It's just so much work. I mean, wouldn't it be okay if we just stayed home and just prayed for a little bit and then came to church? And God would still bring people in that way, right?
I understand what you're saying, but you only have half of it. Okay? Yes, prayer is very powerful. And we can pray for people and they can get we can have miracles of salvation and healing, but that's only half of it. That's half the battle. Let me tell you this. Think about this, okay? There's two farmers, and they're both in a drought. They have no water for to grow their food. So they're both on their knees, and they're praying for God to bring the rain. But only one of the farmers gets up, goes out in the hot sun, and prepares his field. He plants the seeds and gets his field all ready. Who do you think's going to benefit most when God brings the rain?
What do you mean?
Think about this. See, the one farmer went out and he prepared his field. So when the rain came, and it comes, when God brings it, his field's going to grow. And he's going to have a harvest. That's what we have to do. We have to be like him and take action. We got to be like the farmer. We have to take action. We need to give God our best. We need to be in God's will. Not only when it's easy, but sometimes when it gets hard. See, in the Bible, God used many people to do miraculous things. But they had to act in order to see the miracles come.
But who, though? I mean, I don't remember reading the Bible and seeing people pass out flyers and set up tables and chairs in 110-degree weather.
Okay, let me give you an example. Noah.
Noah, the world is filled with evil people. I will start over by destroying everything. I have decided that you and your family will be spared. Build an ark for you and your family to be protected from this great flood. I will give you the plans on how to build it. It will be big enough to fit two of each type of animal.
Yes, my lord. I will do as you commanded.
See, now Noah built his ark. Him and his family built the ark like God told him to. but they had such small tools that it took them over 100 years to build it. But they didn't give up. And so when they were finished, they brought in all the animals that God told them to bring in, got them into the ark, and God spared them. And the rest of the earth died.
I mean, yeah, I know the story.
Yeah, but what if Noah didn't listen to God?
Noah, it is time for the flood. It's coming. Where is the ark?
Funny story. We started building, but then I got tired, and I was like, it's hot, and working on my tan, you know, and we didn't do it. Do you got a spare ark somewhere, maybe in your driveway or something? Oh, no!
So you see what I mean? We need to give God 100%.
I see that, but Noah was so old. And I mean, I'm just a kid. My hard work isn't going to do anything great like his did.
You're wrong. Remember David? He was only 12 years old. He worked hard and he tended his father's sheep. He fought the lion and a bear. He wrote worship songs for God. He even defeated the big giant Goliath. But what if David didn't give God his best and he didn't have faith that God would deliver the Philistines into his hands?
Again, I challenge you, is anyone in Israel ready to fight me?
If only there was someone who would fight this giant. He's been mocking us like this for 40 days.
You weren't talking to me, were you? I'm only 12. I came to bring food to my brothers. I can't fight him. Good luck. Adios.
There's no one in Israel to fight us, then us Philistines will kill you guys! Get him!
I'm starting to see your point of view now. I think. I mean, what about someone in our church? The people in the Bible didn't really go through the things that we go through now.
Okay, I'm glad you're starting to get it now. So, let me give you one more example. Okay, let's take Pastor Warner. Okay, Pastor Warner gave God his 100% best. He went out to preach the gospel to the whole world. So, right before he started this church, he was in a really bad accident. In fact, that's why he's in a wheelchair.
Really? I didn't know that.
So, what if Pastor Warner decided not to give God 100% and not start the church? What do you think would have happened?
Good morning, Ms. Warner. I'm very sorry to tell you that your accident has left you paralyzed and you'll never walk again. I'm sorry.
This has cost me too much. I never thought this would happen. Maybe I'm not called to preach.
That's crazy to think about. I mean, if Pastor Warner didn't give God his 100%, all those kids in the audience wouldn't be here right now. I mean, their parents met in the church. And if their parents didn't meet, then they would have never existed.
That's right. It's amazing what God can do through us, through all of us. All we have to do is give him 100%, and anything can happen. And that's why we need to go out into all the world and preach the gospel.
Jeremiah 29:11. I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. These are words from God to each and every one of us. And if there's one thing we want you to remember from tonight, is that God has a plan for you. You know, I gave my life to Jesus when I was 19. It's been a while. I'm 62 now. Whew, getting old. Before I gave my life to Jesus, I thought if God existed, he was a million miles away and that he never cared about me, never thought about me. But I was wrong. The problem wasn't that God was not thinking about me. The problem was I was not thinking about God. Because that scripture tells us that God thinks about us each and every day. And he has a plan for you. Specifically, you are not an accident. You are not alone. God sees you, and he has a plan for your life. In that scripture, it says that he knows the thoughts he's thinking towards you. They are thoughts of peace and not of evil. God wants to give you peace. There's in Isaiah a verse where it gives a bunch of names of Jesus, and one of them is that he is the Prince of Peace. I know that I have peace of mind ever since I gave my life to Jesus. Before I gave my life to Jesus, I was disturbed. I was bummed out. I'd wake up in the morning, and from the time I opened my eyes to when I went to bed at night, I knew that there was something wrong. It wasn't until after I gave my life to Jesus that I realized it was my conscience telling me that I was not right with God, that I did not have peace of mind simply because I had disobeyed God. I was a sinner, and I desperately needed Jesus to forgive me of my sins. When I gave my life to Jesus, my conscience was clean for the first time in years, and I had peace of mind. I can tell you certainly that Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and God wants to give you that peace on a day-by-day basis. When God sees you, he doesn't scowl and think, oh boy, I can't believe these people. No, when God looks at you, he sees someone he loves. And he wants to give you peace. He has thoughts of peace and not of evil towards you. To give you a future. I was reading in Proverbs, and it uses that same word, future. And it uses it as the word hereafter or afterlife. That God has thoughts of being with you forever. He wants to give you a future. That means he wants to give you eternal life. And Jesus, in John chapter 17, Jesus said that eternal life was to know him, to know God rather, and to know Jesus whom he has sent. That God, that's the thought of God in his mind for you, is that he wants to be with you forever. I know the thoughts I'm thinking towards you, says the Lord. They are thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. And God wants to give you hope here and now and for all eternity. My testimony, I was actually in college and I didn't do very well. I had an opportunity, I cringe at it, but I had an opportunity to look at my grades before I gave my life to Jesus and afterwards, and it was so different. I was not a very good student, and I had no hope at that time of ever finishing college and becoming the person I wanted to become. And yet when I gave my life to Jesus, he gave me hope. He gave me a brand new start in life, and I was able to go back to school and finish my degree. And that was in Sacramento, California. And I came out here to go to the University of Arizona to fulfill that dream I had. Jesus was the one who gave me hope. And Jesus wants to give you hope today as well. You know, I was thinking, what can I use as an illustration to kind of give a picture of how God thinks about us? And then I saw my dog. We have a dog at home named Jasmine. And I thought, yes, we have thoughts towards our dog Jasmine, thoughts of peace and not of evil. We want to help her. We want to give her the best life we can. So what do? We feed her. She's a long-haired dog, and so we will brush her. We'll take her to the vet on occasion. We will take care of her. And the way that we think towards her is a picture of the way God thinks towards us, and he wants to take care of us. He wants to give us peace and a secure future and a hope in life. Those are what God wants to do for you. And in all of that, he sees you and he has thoughts about you. And he has a plan for your life. He has a plan for all the days of your life. You're in his hands. He wants to use you. He wants to bless you. And again, there's one thing we want you to get out of this service tonight is that God thinks about you and he has a plan for your life. I know that this is remote. You're at home or wherever. But I would like you to bow your heads and close your eyes just for a short time, because we would like to have the altar call right now. Perhaps you're listening and you're watching and you've never, ever given your life to Jesus. You've never asked him for forgiveness. When we talk about that God has thoughts of peace and not of evil towards you, you're like, I don't understand that. Well, I didn't either before I gave my life to Jesus. But you have an opportunity right now to ask him for forgiveness, to ask him to come into your life, to give you a brand new start like he gave me, and to give you the promise of a future with him forever. You have that opportunity. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you want Jesus to do all those things I talked about, you want Jesus to forgive your sins, to give you peace of mind, if you want Jesus to give you a brand new start in life, hope for this life and a future in eternity with him, then I would like you to repeat this prayer after me. And not because I'm saying the words. They're just examples of what God wants to hear for someone who wants to give their lives to Jesus. So you're going to be praying not to me, but you're going to be praying to Jesus himself. And it goes something like this. Jesus, I know that I have done bad things. I know that I've disobeyed you. Please forgive me for all those bad things that I have done. And give me peace of mind. Jesus, I know that you died for me, that I might be able to be forgiven, but you rose again from the dead. And that shows me that you have the power to change my life. You have the power to give me that hope in this life and a future with you forever. And I just ask that you would come into my life, that you would give me that power so that I might live the way you want me to live, that you would give me the hope of that salvation. And I also ask that you would help me to live for you and give me a place in your kingdom, that I can be with you forever. Amen. And if you've prayed that prayer, then I am assured that just as Jesus touched my life some 42 years ago, he's touched yours tonight. And You need to talk to somebody. You need to tell somebody what Jesus has done for you. If you've prayed that prayer, you've asked Jesus to come into your life, then tell your parents, tell relatives, tell people from the church. And if you go to another church, not ours, then tell them what you've done. Perhaps tonight you've already done that. You've already asked Jesus for forgiveness. You've already asked him to come into your life. Then I want to talk to you for just a few minutes. Because life, you're young. Life is just starting. But you have eyes. You see what goes on. And perhaps you see adults with problems. Jesus wants to help them. And Jesus wants to help you. No matter what your circumstances are, those words that God put in the book of Jeremiah are true each and every day. I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. And perhaps you're facing things that you need God's help. Then I would encourage you, wherever you are, with your head bowed and your eyes closed, that you take time to ask Jesus for help. And I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you want to repeat this prayer, that would be great. If you want to pray on your own, that would be also great. Jesus, we need you each and every day. We have situations in our lives. We have problems. We have circumstances that we don't have any control over. But you've said that you would give us peace and hope. And we just ask for your help right now, that you would bless us, that you would fill us with your presence and with your spirit, and give us the peace that we need each and every day. And Jesus, we thank you for all that you've done and for how much you love us. And we praise you right now. Amen. That's it.